Okay, we'll start in effect at the beginning. This was a story I wrote one day when I was cleaning out my file cabinets and looking for some way to get rid of a lot of folders full of ideas I knew I would never finish. It's called Beginnings. In order to get started, he went to live alone on an island and shot himself. His blood, unable to resist the final joke, splattered the cabin wall in a pattern that read, "It is important to begin when everything is already over." This maxim, published on the cabin wall between an outdated calendar and a freshwater fish chart, would have pleased him. He'd once begun a story about the raising of Lazarus, in which Jesus, having had the dead man dragged from the tomb and unwrapped, couldn't seem to get the hang of bringing him around. There was an awful stink, the Jews crowding around were getting sick, and Jesus, sweating, was saying, "Bear with me, folks, won't be a minute if I can just get it started, the rest'll come easy." This, then, was his problem, beginning, and having begun, avoiding resolutions. Thus, there were worse jokes his blood might have played on him. Its message might have read, "All beginnings imply an apocalypse." Perhaps, in fact, that's what it did say. How was he to know? Pulling the trigger, he thought, "This is working. I'm getting on." It was comfortable, that cabin, roomy and clean-smelling, with walls of unvarnished Norway pine, Coleman lanterns for light, the wood cook stove, and a long pine table with a yellow checkered oilcloth he'd bought for it, big enough to eat on and write on at the same time. There was a bay out front with a small pier for the boat. He was alone on the island, except for a few squirrels, frogs, muskrats, the odd weasel, birds, porcupines. The nearest people were about a mile's boat ride away. He rarely needed these people, though sometimes he visited them when his imagination failed him or he ran out of peanut butter. On these occasions, they often told him stories, astounding him with their fearless capacity for denouement. And he'd return to his island shaken, thinking, "I'm the last man alive on Earth." Once they told him about a man who had come to one of the islands to write, but on arriving, had shot himself. "Yes," he told them, "that was me." And they noticed then that his head was coming apart, and on the wall was a message, "You ain't seen nothing yet, friends." He once wrote a story about a man who was born at the age of 32 with a self-destruct mechanism in his gonads, such that he could be sure of only one orgasm before he died. This man traveled all over the world seeking out the perfect mate for this ultimate experience, but blew it one night in a wet dream on a jet flight over Bangkok. What was fascinating about this story was neither his travels nor his dream, but rather the peculiar physical appearance of a man kept so long in the womb. He'd rather liked this story and had stayed with it longer than most, but had had to abandon it finally when he'd heard about the new cults forming aboard jet liners. "Well, we've made a start," his blood said on the wall. "Nothing else matters." The people who'd come to identify the body crowded around, staring in disbelief. "This is impossible," they cried. "That story wasn't true. It was only a legend." They noticed that he'd left the coffee pot on the stove and it had boiled over. They pointed to it and said, "Aha," satisfying thereby their lust for a motive, but they couldn't conceal a certain disappointment. They scratched about, however, and finally found enough peanut butter for two sandwiches, though there wasn't any bread. "Well, at least we haven't come for nothing," they said. There was nothing primitive about this island. He had a shallow bay to bathe in, a cabin to eat and sleep in, an outhouse to shit in, a chair to read in, wild blueberries for breakfast, saws and axes for cutting wood, a boat to go to town in, and he could write anywhere. If he subsisted largely on peanut butter, that was his own fault, because he even had a gas refrigerator and stove. These he used as little as possible, though, because his principal hardship was exchanging used butane tanks for new in town, then single-handedly dragging the loaded one back to the boat, later heaving it out of the boat and up the steep hill to the cabin, and finally setting it up in place and lighting it without blowing himself up. As for the old wood cook stove, he loved it. When the lake was darkened by a storm or at night, he could sit for hours in front of it, watching the flames, warming himself, brewing coffee, frying up feasts of fish and potatoes when he had them, imagining a life free of settings forth and so immortal. What limited his use and diminished his enjoyment of the stove was the need to chop wood for it. He found it took about as long to burn the wood as it took to cut it. There seemed to lurk some kind of unpleasant moral here, and it was this more than the hard work, which in his womb-wrinkled condition he should have welcomed, that made him use the cook stove less and less. He would have abandoned it altogether but for his insomnia. On bad nights, he could stare at the flames, each one new, violent, unique, and sooner or later, all this variety would put him to sleep. An ordinary island, then, with ordinary trees and bushes, ordinary bugs, birds and reptiles, ordinary lake water lapping it about. Yet, even before pulling the trigger, he recognized that there was something suspicious about it, as though it might have been, like the air he breathed, just another metaphor. So many otherwise solid and habitable islands had gone that way in the past, it was a kind of pollution. Perhaps he should have shot himself in the boat on the way to the island, spared the world another bloody epigram, and the island this transgression, this erosion. It was Adam did the naming. Why did Eve get all the blame? Because she was near at hand. This was her offense, affectionate trespass. She wanted company. She couldn't leave well enough alone. She had to turn up and tax his vocabulary. She must have come there sometime between the pulling of the trigger and the loosing of his blood and brains against the cabin wall. He named her many times over, but never Eve. What could he say in her behalf? That she helped him drag the butane tanks up the hill. But she helped him use them up faster, too. Yet he was grateful because he was able to throw away everything he'd written before she'd come there, and this altered the fuel balance, permitting more fires in the cook stove. Also, she was good at finding blueberries and cleaning fish. But she confused him by insisting she'd been there first. He was the newcomer to the island, and she lifted her skirts to show him the missing rib. It was at this time that he began to suspect that he, not the island, was the metaphor. He began a story in which the first-person narrator was the story itself, he merely one of the characters, dead before the first paragraph was over. He returned the rib to her and discovered it was more blessed to give than to receive, though this was not accomplished without some bloodletting. They found much peace and pleasure in this sharing of the rib and called it fucking. Thus, he was still naming things. Perhaps because it rhymed with luck. Fucking, they thought, was good for it, good for the raw nerve ends of his navel, too. I think this is the beginning of something, he said as his hips bucked. Though they never let it get in the way of their struggles with one another, it always proved useful whenever they began to repeat themselves. It was almost like a place, somewhere to go when the island and his work became hostile and wounded them, an island within an island. Small wonder, then, that he took to inventing stories in which time had a geography like an island, place moved like the hands of a clock, and point of view was a kind of punctuation. He assigned numbers and symbols to death, love, characters, unexpected developments, transition, then submitted them to the rhythms of numerologies. He invented a story with several narrators, each quoting the next, the last quoting the first, and telling the story being told. He began another, added footnotes, sub-footnotes to the footnotes, further footnotes to the sub-footnotes, and so on, to exhaustion, which came early. He still had something to learn about pacing himself. The woman, like all women, no doubt, was always the same woman and never the same woman twice. Sometimes she was pregnant, sometimes she was not. Sometimes she soaped him up when they bathed in the bay, and then they fucked in the water, or else on the shore, under the trees, in the cabin, out in the wood pile, less often when she was pregnant. She did her best to hide the children from him for fear he'd eat them. Sometimes she was distracted, and then he did eat them. He was always sorry about it afterwards because he missed them, and they gave him constipation for a week, in which case she cared for him, scratched his head, gave him enemas, strewed the path to the outhouse with rose petals. The outhouse was a short walk away from the cabin, up a path made cushiony by dead pine needles, hidden from the cabin by the thick forest of pines, poplars, birch, and dogwood. It was strictly for shitting or thinking, since it was their habit to piss wherever they were when the need hit them, except inside the cabin. Sometimes at night, simply out the front door into the moonlight, hoping not to get bit by mosquitoes, hoping did little good. They got bit anyway. This added purpose and energy to their fucking, but did little to improve their technique. It was like the sting of conscience, teaching them to murder or be damned. The children were less scrupulous about their toilet, with the result that the cabin often smelled worse than the outhouse. On such days, he would take the boat out on the lake and fish for walleyes and bass, pretending to be the good provider. He was not lucky at it, though, and hated taking the hook out. So, sooner or later, he'd go into town and buy fish at the store. The woman was always amazed at his luck in catching filleted fish. "It's a parable," he explained, and put the gun to his head. "Soon, I'll be able to dispense with this gun altogether," he thought with his scattering brain. "It's like taking a cathartic." Sometimes, he thought that might be the way to get started, at last, with a cathartic. But what if the trouble was heartburn? For it was true, his writing was a vice and tended to alienate them. He found he did no writing at all while fucking, and vice versa. Could even be worse in between times when he wasn't sure which he was doing or should be doing. He ate better than when he lived alone, slept better. She even took to chopping the wood and dragging the butane tanks up by herself. He had all the time in the world, and yet, if anything, he was writing less. He used to spill beer, ashes, peanut butter, kerosene into his typewriter and hardly noticed. Now she kept it clean for him, and it kept breaking down. Whenever an idea really gripped him, she would cry and accuse him of leaving the island. He'd apologize and take her for a ride in the boat, wondering where it was he'd been. She diapered the children in the climaxes of his stories, doing him a service. But she also borrowed his typing ribbon for a clothesline and mistook his story notes for a grocery list, nearly poisoning them all. And yet, she was indispensable. When he complained about the suffering of the artist, she added more fruit to his diet, and in truth, he suffered less. Alone, he used to sit in front of the cook stove and listen to the stillness beyond the flames. Now, there was her breathing, and who else was there to read to? He realized he'd been writing so as to be able to sleep at night, but she could purge his guilt with a simple back rub, confirming his suspicion that it was nothing more than a cramp in the lumbar region. When he reasoned that perhaps he needed the writing after all to stay awake in the daytime, she sent the children in to play with him. He began a parody on Plato's cave parable, in which he celebrated not the shadows, but the generosity of the wall. Also, it became important to delay the climax. Thus, he got involved with spirals, revolutions, verb tenses, and game theory. There were puns that could make endings almost impossible, like certain very thick prophylactic devices. He started a story about a man who was granted a wish by a good fairy and kept wishing for more wishes, thereby precipitating the end of the world. He applied Zeno's paradox to a suicide bullet and kept it up all night. He invented a story about Noah in which the old man starts by making the door and the window, then can't figure out how to build the ark around them. God, too, is confused by this approach, but is too proud of his storied omniscience to admit it, and so provides dogmatic solutions which turn out to be self-contradictory. Many volumes of profound arguments ensue. Noah builds himself a captain's bridge, meanwhile, but God, annoyed by its pretensions, turns Noah into a pillar of salt. God instructs Noah on the laying of the keel, but Noah misunderstands the symbology, and consequently, his keel has 14 stems, but no stern. Enough of these false starts, he reasoned, taking his children down to the bay for an afternoon swim, and the flood will never come. It was beautiful, that little bay, clean and quiet, cool, with only the occasional leech like a cautionary tale. Sometimes the turtle would swim in, looking for the old days. The woman would kneel on a flat rock at the lip of the bay like Psyche washing out diapers. On sunny days, schools of tiny fish would arrive like visitors from the city, white and nervous, and birds would come down looking for action. His children splashed at the edges, played in the sand, scrambled about in the boat, chased toads, cried when they got ants on them, peed on the bluebells and each other, ate mud. Now and then one would drown or get carried off by the crabs, and he'd wonder, why do we go on making them if they're just going to quit on us? Neither the woman nor his balls ever seemed to ask that question, and he felt alienated. He contemplated a detective story in which all the victims and suspects are murdered, as well as the detective and all those who come to investigate the murders of the detectives who came before. But he was an intransigent realist. And he knew as he climbed up on the small pier that he'd probably bogged down in the research. He dove off, projecting out a multi-volume work to be entitled Adventures of a Mongoloid Idiot, and struck his head on the bottom, thinking all this from the pulling of one trigger. The message on the blood-spattered wall was a learned discourse on the 47th chromosome of Mongoloid Idiots and its influence on the prime number theorem of imminent apocalypse. Was it enough to say that he'd shot himself because he'd let the coffee boil? Probably it was enough. He'd apparently run out of bread and had been eating his peanut butter between manuscript pages. His typing ribbon was missing. First lines lay scattered like crumbs, and ants were carrying them off. One of them read, "In eternity, beginning is consummation." Much of the island was unvisited, being too thickly overgrown with trees and brambles. You could sink up to your knees in pulp from the last era's forest. His children occasionally wandered off and never returned. Perhaps they were ogres. Probably not, for they'd have heard them snorting and farting on still nights. Sometimes they took the boat around the shore of the island, gathering bleached driftwood. One of these twisted shapes led him to a story about a monster that was devouring the earth in bits and drabs, but he threw it away, recognizing it as genteel autobiography. On one corner of the island, amid tall reeds, herons nested. If my head was on a neck like that, he thought, I might not have to shoot it off. The cabin itself sat in a small, sunny clearing above the little bay with a view out over the lake and other islands. Now and then, a boat passed distantly, putt-putting along. He wondered about the people who used to tell him stories. They probably died when the bombs fell. Some politician did it one morning in a fit of pique or boredom, blew the whole thing up. The earth was never revisited. In time, the sun burned out. The cooling planet shuddered out of orbit and became a meteor, disintegrating gradually in its fierce passage through eons. Nothing was ever known of man. He may as well never have existed. He liked to sit in a chair in front of the cabin in the warm sunshine, gazing out over the blue lake, contemplating the final devastation and thinking, all right, what next? He could just imagine that politician, the last giant of his race, pushing the button and thinking, this is one day they won't soon forget. He sat in the chair less often when the woman was on the island, for he seemed then to attract chores and children like flies. At such times, he would go up and sit among the spiders in the outhouse, contemplating his aesthetic, which seemed to have something to do with molten flats, hyperbole, and scarecrows. He wanted to write about Job's last years after he'd got his wealth back. He thought the central theme should be stated in the title and then abandoned altogether. He had a story about a soldier who'd been in a foxhole for 50 years and who, having forgotten entirely who the enemy was or what his rifle was for, crawled out one day and got shot. He could call it Beginnings. He planned to write about Columbus voyaging to the end of the world and finding it. He imagined an Eden in which nothing grew but always seemed about to. To keep Adam from starving, Eve turned herself into an apple, which, quite willingly, he ate, forgetting that without her he could never find his way out of the place. He shat and called the turd unable, because this was his prerogative. He wiped his ass and, glancing at the paper before dropping it down the hole, saw that it read, "Once upon a time they lived happily, ever after." Maybe I've got cancer, he thought. Though on still days the outhouse could be a little suffocating, the smell was not really unpleasant. It was said that people who grew up in the days of outhouses often longed for that smell for the rest of their lives. The same could be said for piles of dead bodies, the important thing being the chlorinated lime, and to keep the door open. Of course, that was an open invitation to bees and wasps. One thing leads to another, he thought, and that's how we keep moving along. The blast of the gun, the crash in his skull, were already fading, shrinking into history. Wouldn't hear them at all soon, feel them at all. Once, frantically shooing a yellow jacket out the door with a rolled-up manuscript, he hadn't noticed the wasp that had gone down the hole while he'd bobbed up off it. He sat down, and then he noticed it. He howled all the way down the path, through the cabin, and on down the hill to the bay, and what the woman, ever his best critic, said was, "Hush, you'll wake the baby." After that, he always took a can of bug spray with him on trips to the outhouse, learning something as he squirted about the essential anality of the apocalyptic aesthetic. At this time, he was also a great killer of flies. He carried a fly swatter around with him indoors and out, and when he couldn't think how to start a story, he killed flies instead. There were a lot of first lines lying about, including a new one about an apostate priest in a sacred fly cult, but there were a lot more dead flies. "It's too bad they're not edible," said the woman. She prepared him a fresh pot of coffee, then took the boat to town to have another baby and get some food. He knew that what he was doing was good because the flies were holding the earth together. He swatted them badminton style, caught them on a hairline edge of sills and chair arms, laid jelly blob traps for them, and outscored that holy fiend, the tailor, on always with a smiling, self-righteous zeal. Cleanliness is next to whap godliness. He felt like Luther, his finger on the trigger, splattering dark ages against the cabin wall like brains. "It's the beginning of something," he thought, wielding the fly swatter like a pastoral staff. "A disease, perhaps." The coffee was boiling over on the stove when the woman returned. "I think I missed my calling," he said. "It's a boy," she replied, and opened her blouse to give it suck. He understood that there was nothing banal about giving birth, even to mongoloid idiots, and through the first half dozen or so, he suffered nearly as much as she did, writing odes to navel strings and the beauty of ripe watermelons to keep his mind off the unpleasant tearing sensation in his balls. He began a story about a man who brings his wife to the hospital to have a child. They're both excited and very happy. The wife is led away by the doctor, and the man enjoys a sympathetic and good-natured exchange with the staff. The delivery seems to take longer than it ought, however, and he begins to worry. When he asks the staff about it, he gets odd, evasive answers. Finally, in a panic, he goes in search of the doctor, finds him at a party, roaring, drunk, and smeared to the ears in blood. He realizes that, in fact, he's in some kind of nightclub, not a hospital at all. The doctor is a stand-up comedian, delivering a dirty-mouth routine on the facts of life and using his wife's corpse as a prop. The worst part is that he can't help laughing. What shall we do with all these dead, he wondered. The island was becoming a goddamn necropolis. He'd even managed to kill the snake and the frog, though the woman had spared them. It was as though they couldn't escape their natural instincts toward snakes, his panic, her affection. The frog was just one of those innocent bystanders who come along to thicken the plot, like himself or Jesus Christ. The woman was bathing in the bay, standing in shallow water, haloed about with suds, just kissing the surface with her cunt, and he was on his way down the path with shampoo and towel to join her. There was a snake across the path, and he stopped short, his heart racing. Its mouth was stretched around the bottom half of a frog. He could see the frog's heart pounding. In fact, he could hardly see the frog for its thumping panic. He ran to the woodpile and grabbed up an axe. The woman, who had seen his heart pounding in his ears and eyes, came up to see what had frightened him. Her bottom half was dripping wet, and there was soap scum in her pubes. He was trembling as he crept up on the snake with the axe. He thought that the frog might be a decoy, a secret ally, that he was the one the snake was after. It's some kind of identity crisis, he realized. The frog's eyes blinked in the snake's maw. The woman kicked the snake gently. It disgorged the frog, fainted as though to strike, then suddenly was gone. Stupefied still, he hopped a few feet into the underbrush and began a story about the old serpent left behind in Eden after the action had moved elsewhere, who comes on a frog, green as the New Testament, first one he's seen in years, swallows it, and dies of indigestion. She nudged him in the ass with her toe, but he only cowered there, his heart thumping in his ears. She saw that he was in trouble and went down to secure the boat against the coming storm. "It's always like this," he thought. "You just get started, and then the storm comes." He knew that if he wrote a story about the heath, after Lear, the fool, old Tom, and all the rest were dead and gone, just the heath, the storm raging on, phrases lying about like stones, metaphors growing like stunted bushes, it would be the most important story of his age. But he also knew the age would be over before he could ever begin. He no longer believed there would be any message on the cabin wall. "Let's have no illusions," he thought, "about blood and brains." Outside, the wind was howling. The boat was bumping against the pier, and pine branches swept the cabin roof restlessly. They sat inside and played strip poker, starting naked. He drew a pair of queens and a king, but the woman beat him with a heart flush. "Off with his head," she screamed. "What have I got to lose?" he said. The wind blew in and swept the cards away. In bed, their sheets flapped like sails. He awoke the next morning, tangled in first lines like wrinkled sheets. The windows were smashed and birds lay about with broken necks. The woman was down at the bay rinsing diapers. The children huddled about her like the sting of conscience. He went out to pee and saw that the boat had sunk. First lines lay all about like fallen trees, shattered and twisted. Columbus was voyaging to the end of the world and coming home with filleted fish. Jesus was raising mongoloid idiots from the grave. He half hoped that as he peed, the boat would bob to the surface, but it just lay there on the bottom in a gray, sullen stupor, only its gunwales showing like a line drawing for a suppository or a cathedral window. He felt as if he'd opened one too many holes in his body, and the wind had blown in and filled him with dead bees. "It's time to leave the island," he told the woman. "I've already packed," she said. "We'll make a fresh start," he shouted, but she couldn't hear him because the children were crying. She was bailing the boat out with the diaper bucket. "A fresh start." But back in the cabin, the coffee was boiling over on the stove, and he saw there was no bread for the peanut butter. Everything seemed to be receding. They were in the boat, and as they pulled away, the island suddenly sank into the lake and disappeared. "Hey, look," he cried. "You did that on purpose," the woman said. "You always have to try to end it all." He had his reasons, but they didn't justify such devastation. Who was he to be the last giant of his race? Who was he to christen turds? So much for fresh starts. He might as well not have pulled the trigger in the first place. But it was done, and that was an end to it. Or so it said on the cabin wall.